दर्पण दृश्यमान नगरी तुल्यं निजान्तर्गतं पश्यन्नात्मनि मायया बहिरिवोद्भूतं यथा निद्रया यः साक्षात् कुरुते प्रबोध समये स्वात्मानमेवाद्वयं तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये बीजस्यान्तरिवाङ्कुरो जगदिदं प्राङ्निर्विकल्पं पुनः मायाकल्पितदेशकालकलना वैचित्र्यचित्रीकृतं मायावीव विजृम्भयत्यपि महायोगी वयस्वेच्छया तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नमहिदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरा सुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः देवाय तस्मै नमः वर्स 48 योगस्थ कुरु कर्माणि संगं त्यक्त्वा धनञ्जय सिद्ध्य सिद्ध्यो समो भूत्वा समत्वं योग उच्यते सो योगस्थ कुरु कर्माणि वेल योगस्थ रिमेनिंग स्टेडफास्ट इन योगा व्हाट इज दैट योगा सेमनेस ऑफ द माइंड टुवर्ड्स रिजल्ट ऑफ एन एक्शन रिमेनिंग दैट स्टेडफास्ट इन योगा परफॉर्म एक्शंस abandoning attachment and you know remaining the same to success and failure siddhya siddhyo samo bhutva siddhi success asiddhi failure so remaining same well then this will be called yoga he dhananjaya so digvijaye prabhutam dhanam ajayat iti dhananjayah one who acquired a large wealth during his conquest tour is called dhananjaya And so we started this verse, well, which is basically here we'll be discussing Karma Yoga with reference to action. We have, of course, discussed Karma Yoga with reference to result of an action, but here we'll be discussing with reference to action. And so yesterday he narrated whole kinds of Vedic karmas, mainly divided into four portions: Kama karmas. And then Nitya Karmas, Naimittik Karmas and Prayashchit Karmas, Karma of an Atonement, etc. So all these four kinds of karmas are there. And now the purpose of the Karma Yoga here we'll discuss is, in Karma Yoga we give up, you know, Kamya Karma basically and perform Nitya Naimittik Karma as an offering to the Lord. So that's an attitude behind the action. Attitude towards the result of an action we have already discussed, but attitude behind the action is this. Basically, you perform Nitya Naimittik Karmas as an offering to the Lord, and that will definitely purify the mind. And Kamya Karma is a very definition of kamya karma says that kama is involved in that. And so this kama is given up in karma yoga. And Bhagavan, the Bhashyakara says that by performing this various even Vedic rituals, for the sake of antakkarana shuddhi also will be a karma yogi. So karma yogi basically, you know, is maybe having a certain set of karmas which are there. Definitely they are there, particular kind of karmas in which there is an attitude of offering will be easy. But other than that also there are all rituals. Most of the rituals you can do with the attitude of offering. That's a big thing. So if you don't have a kamana behind, a desire to fulfill behind an action, then definitely the same action you can do for the sake of offering to the Ishvara. And so, but Swamiji, who is that Ishvara? Well, the Jagadish Ishvara. As I told you, the Sri Sukta Homa can be done either as a Kamya Karma or even it can be done as an offering to the Lord. You are desiring, in fact, money through that Homa. And lots of noise is there. I don't know who is creating this. Particular action, of course, any ritual, let us say, any ritual can be done with the offering to the Lord. So, for antakkarana shuddhi, we can do it. So, it's not necessary, just a nitya naimittik karmas. Other than the karmas also are there, those karmas can be done as the offering to the Lord and then it becomes a karma yoga. So, if you have a kamana behind to fulfill it, you are a karmi. If you don't have any kamana or any desire to fulfill behind an action and particular ritual, etc., well, you can be a karma yogi with respect to even that action also. So definitely why are you saying like this? Because basically, suppose if I have any kamana behind any action, then definitely I don't have a vyavasayatmika buddhi. I'm not clear regarding what is the goal of life and what is means to fulfill that. And therefore, basically, if that means and end is not clear to me, goal is moksha, and means is not karma, but karma yoga, basically, it's an attitude. So if it is not clear and I have a desire to fulfill behind an action, then definitely I don't have a goal, moksha as such in my mind, and in that case, all my karmas are directed for various goals in the life. And actually there is one goal. If one has discerned that, then there are not many goals. We have discussed this. So, and if I have a vyavasayatmika buddhi, if I am very clear regarding the means and end, then all my karmas are directed towards one goal called moksha, and that becomes karma yoga. We have seen that karma yoga, how it becomes a means for moksha. So, basically, for moksha, you require a particular kind of a mind, antakkaranam, which is prepared. Moksha is not gained through karma, but karma is only for preparing the antakkaranam. And preparing the antakkaranam through karma becomes a yoga for us. So, in the Gita, of course, the word karma is used with reference to Vedic karmas. But when Arjuna was asked to do a karma, then it was not a ritual to be performed. It is not a Vedic karma. He was to fight. And so it was his duty. So Bhashyakara also confirms this. And Bhashyakara says this fighting is this yuddha, etc., is to be done for a kshatriya. It's an obligatory karma. So Bhagavan says that you convert fighting the war, into yoga. So means you are a kshatriya and you are fighting for the sake of dharma. And so take it as an offering to the Lord, and therefore you can convert this action. So it means it definitely indicates that just with some particular Vedic karmas we will do with a certain attitude can become a karma yoga. It is not so. Any karma can be converted into karma yoga. So karma yoga basically covers all activities in general. And earning money from earning money to any karma we can do, we can convert it into karma yoga. Basically, karma has a stamp that this karma is a karma yoga. No, it's not so. because it's an attitude. And therefore, if you change the attitude, if you don't have a desire to fulfill because you have a vyavasayatmika buddhi, you are very clear what is the goal of life, what are the means, etc. In that case, any action you can convert into karma yoga because you change your attitude as an offering to the Ishvara. And of course, lastly, we will again see what is the role of Ishvara in karma yoga. We'll do that before I finish up this verse. But right now I'm concentrating on this another definition of our karma yoga, that is yoga karma su kaushalam, karma yoga with reference to action. So karma yoga covers basically all activities, and if karma is taken to I mean any action performed well, which is actually meaning of the word, then you have to look at karma from the standpoint of the entire life. And so actions thus, then referred to will be those activities that you perform in the attempt to fulfill our ragadveshas. Most of our activities has a base to fulfill ragadveshas. And since we have a ragadvesha behind all our activities or actions, they need to be neutralized. And therefore, you can pick up any karma and you know that behind that there is some ragadvesha, and you can convert into a karma yoga and neutralize your ragadvesha. And as such, that's an attitude only will detach you from ragadvesha, or you can come out of the sway of a ragadvesha, and therefore other than there is no other way in fact to be free from the ragadvesha. Really, there is no other way. We cannot just remove, like I have some hat and I remove it, and the same way ragadveshas are there, let me remove it. You cannot do. You have to change an attitude behind an action, and most of our activities have a in background some ragadveshas, and therefore you can pick up any action and convert into a karma yoga with a certain attitude, and then definitely you will not be under the control of ragadveshas. So otherwise ragadveshas cannot be given up as such, because they constitute the person as such. So when we perform an action with the sameness of a attitude towards the result of an action, ragadveshas automatically get neutralized. Generally, we don't have a ragadvesha for a karma. We have ragadveshas with reference to result of an action. And definitely, then if the result of an action will be taken with the attitude of a sameness, samatvam yoga uchyate. So with the, then definitely ragadveshas are neutralized. And this attitude is called karma yoga. And that attitude of samatvam mentioned in the Veda, in this verse of course, is not with reference to action, but it is with reference to result of an action. And that attitude, of course, is present in the Vedic culture. We have seen it as a prasada buddhi. So, the different situations which occurs in your life, basically they are nothing but karma phala, result of an action, past actions. And those situations, definitely one can take it as a prasada. This prasada buddhi attitude is an important aspect of a karma yoga. What we call sameness is nothing but this prasada buddhi. If there is a prasada buddhi, then only there is a sameness. Otherwise, there is no sameness. So everything can be taken as a prasada. My physical body, if I see my child as a prasada from the Lord, then my body also is prasada to others, and also to me also. A house is a prasada, and the food cooked, offered, eaten also is a prasada. So prasada buddhi is one which brings a sameness towards various situations in life, and definitely then you can neutralize your ragadveshas towards those situations. So it is and one important thing we have to notice, that generally they say you should perform an action without expecting a result, etc. Well, that has no basis in the Veda. Such an interpretation serves only to create some additional complex. And as I told you, the truth is no one can perform action without expecting a result. So definitely the karma, so this kind of a meaning of a karma yoga we have to abandon. It is not possible. In fact, Bhagavan has also taught with a certain expectation that Arjuna will understand. So he is also, action is And Arjuna also has expectation. Everyone has expectation. And expectation will remain and it has to be there. So nothing wrong. But if it is not even, if the result will not be as per the expectation, well, then our attitude of the sameness or prasada will help us to be free from the reactions in the mind. That sameness only will remove the reactions. And reactions are born because of the raga-dveshas present. And the attitude of sameness is there, prasada buddhi is there. Raga-dvesha will not get a support. That's a big thing. So that is how we are neutralizing our raga-dveshas, which are generally not behind the action, towards the result of an action. And so sameness towards the result of an action and or the prasada buddhi towards the result of an action is a part of karma yoga, one part of karma yoga. Now also, although this verse present a particular line of argument, the fact is that this is not the only way to way of looking at it. And so we pull the other definition of karma yoga from verse number 50, and we'll discuss here because there is some connection between the two. If karma yoga is just defined as a sameness towards the result of an action, well, it has certain drawback. And therefore, in order to fulfill, in order to make it free from such drawback, we have to discuss the another part of karma yoga, another definition of karma yoga. And that is what? Yogaha karmasu kaushalam. And so kaushalam karmasu. Karmasu means with reference to actions. So with reference to actions, there is a yogaha. And that yogaha is kaushalam. And kaushalam means, definitely you can understand very well, it's a state of a mind or a disposition of a mind which is of a kushalaha. Kushalasya bhavaha kaushalam. So the person is a kushalaha and his disposition of mind is called kaushalam. But what is that kaushalam? Expertise. So the kushalaha means expert, and his disposition of mind or his disposition as such is expertise. So karmasu kaushalam is expertise in action or skill in action, either. Skill in action is karma yoga. Well, how far that is true, we'll have to see. This definition also has a drawback, like previously I told you. I have told you, that you should perform action without expecting any result. That is karma yoga. Well, that's a full of, that's impractical. No one can do that. Same way, just a skill in action is karma yoga is not a correct definition. So anyway, but this is modern people generally say this way. All the modern world, including all these corporate people also, they like this Bhagavad Gita seminars, Gita management and all this. And they define like this, skill in action, which is not correct. So, but skill is a desirable thing, efficiency is a desirable thing, expertise is a desirable thing. But it is not that karma yoga is about. And therefore, there is this, kaushalam means expertise or skill or efficiency, etc. is not a proper translation. It is inappropriate to define or make equivalent with karma yoga. Karma yoga is a religious attitude and it has some other dimension. So the skill in action is interpretation, as I told you, is a wrong interpretation. So if you are very skillful in action, you are a karma yogi, it seems then. So we have to abandon that. This is not, it's a secular translation basically designed to bypass Ishwara. That is how it is. Skill in action means where the name of Ishwara is not there, role of Ishwara is not there, nothing. And therefore it's a secular definition, and it is not correct. There are people who read this, Gita without recognizing Ishwara. Whole Gita they read, but they never see any role of Ishwara anywhere. You can imagine what way they are reading, we don't know. Everywhere Ishwara is telling that I and me and mom, everything he is using. Somebody told me Bhagavan has a very bigger ego, because in Bhagavad Gita he has used all. He has used aham, he has used mam, he has used maya, he has used mama, he has used mahyam, he has used asmat, and he has used mai. You will find all this, what I say. All vibhaktis is used pertaining to I. In me and by me and to me and I. एक्सेट्रा होल टाइम आई आई आई. सो समबडी सेज ही इज ईगो. ईश्वर इज वेरी इगोइस्टिक. सी ऑल द टाइम ही इज यू नो ब्रिंग फोर्थ हिज ईगो. वेल बट सो इवन इन सच ए थिंग इज देयर. लेट्स से दैट. लेट्स एक्सेप्ट. एंड इवन दो ईश्वर इज टेलिंग लाइक दैट एंड स्टिल होल गीता पीपल रीड filtering Ishwara from the entire section, from the entire Bhagavad Gita. So those who want karma yoga, well, without recognizing Ishwara as a karma faladata, well, simply is not a correct way of understanding. So there is karma yoga only when Ishwara is recognized. Because we have very initially, I have all told you, karma yoga is a prayerful attitude. Is the attitude itself is a result. The very attitude itself neutralizes raga dvesha. You need not have to expect any kind of a karma phala. The attitude behind the action itself neutralizes raga dvesha. And well, if you want that way, then definitely Ishwara has to come into the picture. And therefore, it's a religious attitude. The offering attitude itself purifies you. There are several attitudes behind an action, but an attitude of offering to Ishwara is a very purifying attitude, and therefore Ishwara has to be there in the entire picture of a karma yoga, whatever the way you define. It's an yoga behind an action or yoga behind a result of an action. Either way, Ishwara is there behind an action. And Ishwara is there even in the attitude towards either action or result of an action. And therefore, karma yoga basically is a religious attitude, prayerful attitude, devotee's attitude. And so, there is no way of escaping this Ishwara. And therefore, there is no such thing as a secular karma yoga. So, just a skill in action, expertise in action, etc. Well, that is not the correct definition, and I will show what is the drawback in that. See, when there is a skill in action, when there is efficiency, then let's say then the person is karma yogi, as per them. Then yogi may be efficient, this karma yogi is an efficient in a particular field. When he ventures into another field, initially he will not be expert, naturally. Therefore, now such a person is called karma yogi or not. The person, suppose he is very, very, very skillful in his medical field. Let's say, let me just an example. And he is very expert in medical field. And we say then skill in action, efficiency in action, whatever he does is does a surgery or whatever, or a diagnosing the disease, etc. Let's say, okay, he is very expert. So, and he is a karma yogi. Okay, then no problem. But suppose the person has not learned at driving a car. Suppose, example, he has not learned at driving a car. Now he is learning. Now he cannot be expert on a first day or a next day. It takes time. Now you were calling, this person is a karma yogi with reference to a particular field. Now while for driving a car, now what will you call? No, Swamiji, he is not expert. Then will you call him a karma yogi or not? No, he is not a karma yogi then. Then you say he is a karma yogi. Now karma yogi is driving a car or learning to drive a car. Now how will you say it? How will you say it? So this is not the way to say. Efficiency in action is a karma yoga. Well, it is not. Because he is not an expert in another field. So skill in action means now he is driving. But he is not skillful. He is learning. Now you have made a general statement. Skill in action is a karma yoga. And one who has it is a karma yogi. But now he is driving and he is not skillful. What will you say then? So the same person is a karma yogi and same person is not a karma yogi? How will you say it? So this is a problem. Anyway, so he has not acquired the necessary skill, etc. And so he will be inefficient with in this respect. So a karma yogi can definitely be an inefficient person in a given area. Okay, a karma yogi. Therefore, if the person who has a efficiency in action is a karma yogi, please withdraw. Because karma yogi is inefficient in a particular area. सो इनएफिशियंसी ऑल्सो गोज विथ कर्मयोगी एंड एफिशियंसी ऑल्सो गोज विथ कर्मयोगी वेल इट कैन नॉट बी इट कैन नॉट बी एंड ऑर एल्स यू विल हैव टू से नो आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू विदड्रॉ द डेफिनेशन ओके डोंट विदड्रॉ बट यू हैव टू एक्सेप्ट दैट दिस कर्मयोगी इज इनएफिशियंट इन ए पर्टिकुलर एरिया राइट यू विल हैव टू टेल Oh, Swamiji will learn driving and then he will be efficient. No problem. Then there is third field. At least he is not knowing proper cooking. if he jumps into a kitchen and tries to cook something, he will make something new, which nobody can eat. And therefore, basically, there are thousands and thousands of areas in which the same karma yogi, whom you call it as expert, is not expert. And therefore, I would put the definition like this. Karma yogi is one who is not having efficiency in many areas. You say karma yogi is one who is expert or efficient in action. I would say karma yogi is one who is inefficient in more than one areas. Now what will you say? And you have in your mind efficiency and karma yoga and expertise and karma yoga skill and karma yoga now with the same karma yogi I am putting in that he is not an expert he doesn't have proper skills what will you say so withdraw that definition that is not a proper definition this is one thing this is just one thing now reverse the thing what because a person is efficient in a given area does not mean he is a karma yogi That definition has a big drawback. That's a big drawback. A person is expert in a given area, still he cannot be called karma yogi. That's another way of we can look in. And the example, you know, Pujya Swamiji used to give a pickpocket person. And therefore, if for example, he's very efficient in picking pockets. Where if I try, how can I call him efficient? Because if I try it, I will be caught. Anyway, so even before I pick, I will be picked up by the police. And therefore, picking pocket is not an easy thing. So he must be a person who is a karma yogi, a skillful person in action. Well, he is a skillful person. Will you call him a karma yogi? A pickpocket is a karma yogi or what? So definitely, this is not a proper definition. So, yogi in action may be skillful, but this does not mean that the skill in action is yoga. That's definitely not. It's a desirable thing. Expertise is a desirable thing in a action. It is okay. Skill in action is a desirable thing. Efficiency in action is a desirable thing. Well, we accept it, but don't equate with karma yoga. That's all. Don't equate with karma yoga. Okay. So, the burden has come, come on the word kaushalam. How we'll interpret this word kaushalam? Thus, if you say the kaushalam means expertise, etc., well, if it is not properly defining, then what is the meaning of the word kaushalam in the definition? Yogaha karmasu kaushalam. Well, if you say the expertise, etc., or efficiency, etc., is not in action, is not a karma yoga, then how will you define it? Yeah. So, we'll now try to fulfill it. We'll try to explain. So, to understand this meaning of the word kaushalam, we'll have to go back to the first definition. That is samatvam yoga uchyate. So, where the yoga we have defined, karma yoga we have defined as a sameness. Towards the different situation, which is nothing but a result of an action. Suppose a man says to a Swami that, I have my own ragadveshas and I like my neighbor's money. And he has converted his whole money into jewelry, gold and other things, because he doesn't want to keep the cash, etc. So he has converted and he used to, at a regular interval, he used to bring it out from the safe. And used to count everything, his ornaments and everything, and I have seen from my window. And since then, I have my eye on his jewelry or gold. And I have my raga dvesha, means I have raga for his money, and I have also dvesha for that person. Why? Because I dislike him, because he is very, very, you know, very proud of his money. And therefore, he shows his riches and etc. He thinks he is a very big shot and etc. And therefore, I dislike, I hate this person. But I like his money, definitely. I like his gold. So, I have ragadvesha. And well, and you said you should, you have a choice behind an action and you can choose an action. Well, then I have chosen an action. What? To steal that gold from his home. And I have done all my, I have planned out very well. I have dug a tunnel also, which can reach to his room, etc. And almost I have reached. Now, and I have heard of your Karma Yoga lecture, and you said sameness towards the result of an action is a Karma Yoga. So, and that prasad, you can take it as a sameness, means a prasad buddhi. So, okay, I am going to take whatever comes, evil as a prasad. Well, and I feel that definitely, because this fellow does not leave the his home. All the time he is 24/7 is there. And this pandemic means another problem. And so he is all the time there in the home. But anyway, I have decided, whatever it may be, but I will, whatever the situation may be, but whatever result come, I am going to accept it with a prasada. Whether I am going to get through, get away with his gold, fine. If I cannot get away and suppose I break open his safe and I may not find him more, maybe one or two things, well, I will take it as a prasada. Or even before I break open his safe and he wakes up in the night, I am going to do, and so if he wakes up, well, and definitely he shot me, I will take it as a prasada. Or he will call police and I will be handed over to the police. And police will strike on me. Every strike of that, the stick, I will take it as a prasada. Whatever is there, I will take it as a prasada. And then will I be a karma yogi or not? And Bhagavan said, I really love this karma yogi. And I want to be loved by the Ishvara. And therefore, tell me now, sameness towards the result of an action is karma yoga, you said. So I will be called karma yogi or not? What to say? It is for this person's sake, we have another definition. That's how we have pulled from verse 50 here. So we have to say yoga karmasu kaushalam. Kaushalam is a discretion of your karma, in your karma basically, in your choice. So it's a choice with certain discretion, meaning that your choice should be in keeping with certain norms. Norms. This is another important aspect of a karma yoga. The first definition, of course, is, well, we have seen with reference to the result of an action, karma phaleshus samabhava and samatvam, etc. And that defines karma yoga as an attitude of samatva, whereas this definition, yoga karma sukaushalam, is with reference to action itself. And here, kaushalam means what? Is our capacity to interpret correctly before I exercise my choice. So this capacity to interpret with reference to norms for human interaction is the expertise, is the kaushalam. So the norm for human interaction is what then? Well, that norm should be the norm for all human beings. That should be the norm. You cannot have a personal norm, because every human being will have a choice. He is going to do karma as per the choice. He is going to choose. And therefore, the norm also should be common to all, which we call universal norm. So the norm for human interaction is the dharma, and the opposite is adharma. Dharma and adharma form the standard norms. So they are not absolute actually, they have to be interpreted according to a given situation. So the person who can interpret them properly is a kushalaha, is expert. So the person who interpret properly and then choose as per the universal norm, keeping in dharma, he does an action. Well, he is called expert in action, or that is a skillful person in action. That is a kaushal, expertise in to interpret dharma properly. And dharma and adharma are not to be interpreted according to one's convenience, must be in line with what is proper, proper for all. That is. So we'll see that proper interpretation of dharma is meant by kaushalam. So kaushalam is a yoga. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. Karmasu kaushalam yoga. So kaushala is a yoga because we are, as such, we are not in the hands of raga dvesha when we exercise this kind of a discretion in your choice of action. When we take into account these universal norms, definitely our raga dveshas are handled. And so we'll see that. So this dharma and adharma are universal things, universal norms. So man in our story, he told very clearly he has a raga dvesha. His raga is for the money and dvesha for his that neighbor to whom the money belongs. And he wants to go by his raga dvesha. He has a choice of stealing somebody's money because of his raga dvesha. And so definitely, but there his choice is against the discretion, inaction, against the universal norm. And therefore, his choice is against, totally against dharma and adharma. So what should not be done, he is doing. So he is going against dharma. And so, we can say he is doing adharma. We can say that way. And but before that, Swamiji, this stealing is not dharma, is not a proper. Who has decided? Who has decided? We should understand this. If it is a man-made law, then definitely we could transgress. If we could not transgress, there also there is a problem. But let's say that man-made norm, is it a man-made norm that stealing is not proper, or it is something beyond that? So suppose in a particular country, there is no law against stealing. Let us say that. Does it mean that if a person takes away, which belongs to somebody else, would it be proper or not? Suppose there is a no law. If I steal your money, suppose example, if I steal your money, but in United States, suppose there is no law against stealing. Like country does not consider stealing is improper. Let's say. Then what? If I steal your money, is it proper or not? Because country does not have that law. So we say it is not true. It is with, like a traffic rule, right? You may have one kind of a rule. I don't know, it's a right-hand drive or it's left-hand drive. I don't remember right now. But a particular traffic rule is there. So we proceed on the right because to do otherwise is definitely a risk to a life, and it is also illegal depending upon the traffic law. But so even if you say that you are ready to take the risk and you want to drive on a wrong side, the police will not allow you because you are not the only one involved. Other people also will be in a danger if you drive on a wrong side. So we can describe this kind of a convention which is man-made. So, but is the law against stealing is man-made or not? Well, the law that stealing is not right is not man-made because it is universal. If no one had anything that was his or her own, there would be no stealing. Like whatever is there is for all, suppose. No one has that sense of belonging to few things, whatever are there, then definitely then there is no stealing. Because even though there would be people, there would be nothing to steal. And therefore no one can steal from the other. But however, everyone has something of his or her own, and therefore there is and then someone takes away that, we call it as a stealing. There is going to be a stealing. So even as Swami has a begging bowl and a mala, and there are two very important things for that Swami, and they are the symbols of a sadhu basically, and he is supposed to carry them. And there are thieves which take away this thing also. Because generally the mala is of a Rudraksha. And that Rudraksha mala, some of the malas are very costly. That's one thing. So some thieves definitely take away that. And then this begging bowl also, you may think what is that in Kamandalu. That Kamandalu. That Kamandalu is an imported thing, by the way. The sadhus use an imported thing. It's an imported, I think from Indonesia or something. A particular kind of a fruit, maybe I think fruit or vegetable, I don't remember. But from there they make it dry and then they inside whatever is there, they remove it and make that kind of a kamandalu like thing. And now this is not available, of course, and that's how artificial kamandalus are available. But that kamandalu which was imported from Indonesia or some country like that, oh, it was very costly. So it happened so that the whatever the sadhu had as a symbol, this kamandalu and the mala, there are thieves for these also. They all take away that. So they have become rare because, and therefore they are costly, and so somebody picks up. Even the Rudraksha also, people have an eye on the Rudraksha mala, because some of the Rudraksha mala are very rare now. There are now artificial Rudraksha malas are also there, which doesn't have any stuff in that. But anyway, so even sadhus can lose few of their possession. And so as long as anyone has something that is his or her own, there is such a thing called stealing. And therefore, this is universal. Stealing is not a man-made thing. Stealing is a universal thing. And therefore, like adharma, dharma also is universal and is not man-made. So dharma is something that is commonly sensed by a human being and is meant for human interaction. So I live and let live. And I want to be, of course, left alone. Not in that sense of, I don't want to... I don't want that few possessions which I have to be stolen, definitely. So at the same time, I let others live in the same way. I should not steal somebody's possession, somebody's objects. So there is a particular order, of course, that is sensed commonly. And this order we call as a dharma. And is the very basis upon which we are supposed to interact with our fellow beings. The scriptures also then confirms it. Actually it is there. The choice is given to the human being. And where the choice is there, there itself this also is given. The norm is also given what to choose. It has to be given. When the choice is there, you should be given a manual also. How to choose, etc. And so the norm is also given to every human being. Still scriptures come and codify that. Don't steal anybody's property. You know, in Yama, I think Asteya or something is there. So Asteya, don't steal anybody's property, anybody's thing, anybody's possession. And so scriptures come and codify and say, well, if you do that, it is papa. If you steal, it is papa. So the scriptures generally do not tell what is right and wrong. Right and wrong is right here, frankly speaking. Scriptures without studying the scriptures, I know what is right and what is wrong. I should not steal somebody's possession. Well, that's a correct thing that I know very well. If I steal, it's a wrong thing, I know very well. So therefore, dharma, dharma, etc. or right, wrong, etc. is clear in my mind. But still, dharma shastra generally codifies and tells that if you do that, if you do a dharma, well, definitely there is a papa. And if you follow dharma, etc., there is punyam, etc. So scriptures the world over merely confirm the existence of that common sense dharma. Everyone can sense this, and so that universally sensed dharma is basically that dharma is confirmed by the scriptures. So it is not that they came into world at a particular period of time, and finding that there was no dharma, then scriptures thought, okay, let's establish dharma. People knew with what was right and wrong even before the scriptures came along. And therefore this dharma adharma is so depending upon that dharma and adharma, particular norm of a right and wrong, which is universally right and wrong, of course, well, one chooses one's action, then we say this person is expert in doing an action. Why you call expert? We'll see. Then, so common sense dharma is there for a human being because he or she has a choice in action. And this choice implies a set of norms which must be known. If these norms, you know, the dharma, were not this, the creation would be defective. Well, because the human being is created, choice also is given, and but the norms Ishvara forgot to put place inside, then it the creation would be defective. So you could not have a, I mean, you could not have been given a choice without being given these norms that goes along with the choice. And therefore, it is like, you know, it. Swamiji was giving an example of a Ferrari. So it is like, you know, you give a Ferrari to a person, then the Ferrari does not have a brakes. And you give to a person such a Ferrari without brakes to someone who is drunk and who also doesn't know how to drive. What will happen? This is the situation. So the person is there, he has a choice. His choice is choiceless. You imagine, what a choice. Over a choice, you do not have a choice. Amazing. Just to take an action of eating, take an action of taking a walk. Several ways you can do. Several ways. What to eat, how to eat, where to eat, when to eat, how much to eat, and what kind of a food should I eat, and what. What time should I eat, with what people I should eat, how, in which manner I should eat. Some people eat, you know, before sitting, on the sofa, that's in the front of the TV, there's some kind of a show going on. So they don't sit in near that, on the dining table. They sit there. I mean, there are so many ways. People sometimes sit on the swing, I mean, they sit on the swings and eat the food in the evening, outside in the balcony or something. So, I mean, what a choice. A single action. It's number of choice. Pujya Swamiji is to tell that there is no choice over a choice. I mean, it's a choiceless. It has no choice means there is no control over your choice. And therefore, it is a Ferrari without a brake. And therefore, definitely, if Bhagavan forgets to put the norms, how to choose, etc., well, then definitely it will be a defect in the creation. So then, having been given a choice, the norm should be common to all without any education being necessary. This is an important aspect of the dharma. To be given a choice and but no knowledge of the norms would also be a defect in the creation. So if I have to be educated for the norms, then you will find that some of the people would not be educated. The people are living in the Amazon or something, you know, in the forest. Who will go and teach them this dharma? But still, they also know. That shows that no education is necessary. And otherwise, suppose this kind of a universal norm has to be taught, and suppose one does not get an education of that, then what happens, you know? For them, the stealing, etc., or getting hurt, etc., hurting others, etc., well, would be, they would not consider it as something bad or a dharma, because they say, we don't know. That is bad. Hurting others is a bad thing. Stealing is a bad thing. No, it's a dharma. A dharma, they would not know. But there is not a single person who says, well, that this I don't know. He knows very well. He knows very well that hurting others is a wrong thing, etc., or stealing also is a wrong thing. They were never taught, and they will not be taught also. So without any education, I know that I should not steal or get hurt, etc., or I should not hurt others. I also know that the others do not want to be stolen from or to be hurt, and that is how there is a common norm between all the human beings. There is a common norm of a behavior we all have, and in a common norm in actions. So what is equally common to you and me is the norm on the basis we choose our actions. So what you don't want from others, and you find others also do not want from you, and that is how we call it as a common sense ethics or common sense norm, or called dharma, or called universal norm, whatever you say. And there is a common sense norm, common norm, dharma, etc., and the person who is able to interpret his or her to be done action in terms of dharma has a kaushalam, or that person is called kushalaha. expert, expertise in action is karma yoga. So then this is expertise, not any other skill, etc., or efficiency, etc. Well, that is not correct. He may have it and it is desirable. That's correct. But this is the definition. So let's now complete that, our story of that gentleman who wanted to steal that gold of his neighbor. So he wants to, that man who wants to continue his plans to steal the neighbor's gold, etc., and take the result as a prasada, he will be only fulfilling one part of Karma Yoga definition, and the other part will remain unfulfilled. What part he is fulfilling? Whatever happens as a result, I am going to steal. Whatever happens as a result of that stealing, I will take it as a prasada. I will have a sameness. And whether I get it, okay. Whether I get more than expected, fine. Whether I get as per my expectation, fine. Whether I don't get anything, or maybe a simple ring or something is there in the safe, he has all taken away everything and kept somewhere else, no problem, sameness. But or he may beat me, or he may short me, well, that also will be okay. So he has a sameness, he has a prasada buddhi in the result of an action. Well, so he is a karma yogi in one part, but definitely not the other part. And that's how both the things should be there. Understand, Karma Yoga has both the definitions which complement with each other. Definitely, because this kind of people will be there who will argue with you like this. So the other part of the definition will remain unfulfilled for this person, because there is no kaushalam for that person. What is a kaushalam? I have already told you. So the person who is able to interpret his or her to be done action in light of dharma, in light of universal norm, or in light of common sense ethics, well, he is called Kushalaha, and his person, that person's state of mind is called Kaushalam. Kushalasya bhavaha Kaushalam. And this person definitely is going against in very dharma, therefore we cannot call him Karma Yogi. So if someone wanted to robe him, well, how would he take it? He also will not allow. The same way he should not robe somebody's property or somebody's possession. So definitely that's a wrong action which he is going to do. It is a dharma, and therefore he is not a karma yogi. So this is and you can understand that even though we say nowadays, Swamiji, in the society there is no dharma and etc., but I don't agree. Even today, if you go out, you come back home safely with whatever money you have taken, and suppose you have spent some money, that's a different thing. But other money somebody has stolen away, or somebody has cheated, or just to come out of your home and people start cheating you and stealing your money or hurting you, it's not like that. Still, the society at large, we have a peaceful society that shows very well that people are observing the norms, which are common sense ethics, or the norms, common norms between the two people, they are observing. You may find some person, that's okay, but that who is doing this. But all, somebody, now in this Kali Yuga, there is no dharma at all people are adharmic, etc. That's not correct. That adharma is in your mind, it is not outside. So all the benevolent things are still there in the society. And therefore, if everyone is following adharma other than you, entire society, starting from your neighbor in the and all the neighbors in the street, and the entire county, and entire district, and entire state, and entire country, all politicians, everyone corrupt and adharma, everything, there would be utter confusion in the society. There would not be order. But you won't find that. You may find few people who are not following the norms. That's correct. But society at large right now also has an order. Indicates, and in that situation, I tell you, if that kind of a situation will be there when everyone is following a dharma, I am sure you could not live your life. Person's life would be ended, because one wants to steal your money, other wants to hurt you, or someone wants to rob you, I mean, all, it, then you cannot leave at all. But you live your full life. And some most of our people are also without any cheat or without any dishonesty, etc., or without any robbery, etc. Whole life, 70, 80, 19 years we live. That shows all other people, other than even me, are definitely following dharma. Otherwise, if they are all adharmika people, how would the society, any person in a society can live? Just think. Therefore, this is, you know, any time, that's a very, I feel it's a, this is human psychology. Any one place, any wrong thing happens, they will generalize the statement. Like any one bank manager, we find him a corrupt person and his story came in the newspaper. Then immediately, in the evening when they meet in the garden, here that's not a chance in the India I'm talking, when these, you know, elders, they meet in the garden, they say like that, all bank managers are like that, they're all corrupt. This statement is not correct. In fact, that is born from tamoguna, that you make a generalized statement. Everyone is adharmika, everyone is like this. It is born of purely tamoguna. You make a generalized statement. One person is corrupt, everyone is corrupt. One person is dishonest, everyone is dishonest. Even one sannyasi has done something wrong which he is not supposed to do. Then all sannyasis are like this. All sannyasis are like that. That's how I keep away. And I tell my wife also to be away from such people. I tell him, she goes all the time to ashram. I tell her not to go. She doesn't understand. She doesn't have buddhi. Something like that. I mean, you make a generalized statement. So somewhere in the society, and somehow the social media, etc., or even print media, let us say newspaper, in India, here I don't know, but somehow they all the time highlight this kind of thing only. Here so many people, some person was kidnapped, and here this person was murdered, and this happened, and here the theft happened, and the page is full of that. And so it makes us to believe that everywhere in the society, if there is a utter confusion, there is no order, everyone is following the dharma, etc. And you go throughout day in and day out, you go out and you come without any cheating, without any robe, without any stealing, etc. And still in your mind, it doesn't occur to make a shift in your vision that society at large is following dharma. Otherwise, how can you live comfortably? So people are like, the way you are following a dharma, you are going through certain norm, other also is doing, and that is how there is a harmony. Otherwise, how can there be harmony? You don't want to cheat others, but any other person wants to cheat you, other than you and your family. Suppose everyone in the street, all neighbors have a cheating tendencies, let's say that. How will you live? You cannot live a day because somebody wants to cheat and somebody other also is an adharmika person, he wants to hurt you. How will you live? It's a very wrong tendency. I get sometimes excited because this is a tamoguna. Bhagavan said in 16th chapter, this is purely tamoguna, to make a generalized statement regarding society, regarding politicians, regarding sannyasis, regarding everybody, regarding country. Oh, India is like this only. USA means like this only. This means this only. Make a general statement. That shows there is no thinking involved. And thinking is not involved because the disposition of mind is a dull. Dullness is there. Therefore, you are not able to think. I'm not telling you. Don't. I'm telling you a general thing. Don't think that way. But, so this is how it is. Never take from today, never make a general statement. Never make, because your this impression will be deferred when you meet a person who is of an opposite quality. So don't make a general statement, and that is what I'm telling here. So adharma means definitely there is adharma. There are people who are given to adharma, that they are there because of certain greed, etc. Well, that's there, but society at large is like you. Now you consider the way, whatever way you want to. You put yourself in a category, which whatever category you like, you put. Society is like you because there is a harmony between two people. That shows that what you are behaving towards the other, other is also behaving in the same manner towards you. That's how the harmony. And that is how whole our life goes like that. With harmony, with order, with no confusion. And therefore, that is not correct that this is a Kali Yuga and people are not following. And in this pandemic, you will find there are people, and so many people who are helping in so many ways. There are people who are doing prayers from the home. And there are people who are doing, we are going out and helping, even at the risk of their life. And therefore, anyway, so of course the choice is there, and so people are sometimes going to abuse their power of choice. That objectivity should be there. Yeah, that people, human being has a choice, and people out of the pressure of that raga dvesha, they sometimes abuse the choice and given to a dharma. But Pujya Swamiji was quite against to brand any person as a adharmic person or like that. He used to tell, a person is given to a dharma, person is given to a particular mistake, hari, but you don't call him totally like this, because in the eye of a Vedanta, everything of course is ultimately Brahman, and therefore everything is sacred, by the way, and his nature is sacred, because what he loves is dharma. Please understand, what he loves is dharma. He loves truth, he loves honesty and everything. So that is his nature. What he loves is nature. But due to the pressure of the raga dvesha, he abuses his choice, definitely. And people, the person who is a karma yogi, definitely he keeps his choice. In keeping with the dharma. So he is able to interpret his or her to be done actions in terms of dharma. And that is called Kaushalam. So, Yogaha Karmasu Kaushalam. And now, tomorrow I will give you the summary of the definition of Karma Yoga, as well as I think we'll discuss the Ishvara's role also in Karma Yoga. And then we'll finish that verse. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.